Hello, thank you so much for joining us today. My name is Haim Israel, Global Strategist and Head of Thematic Investing in Bank of America Global Securities. I'm so pleased and honored today to be joined by Jack Hidary, the co-founder and CEO of Sandbox, one of the global leaders of AI quantum computing that we're going to speak about today, about the revolution. So Jack, given all this and everything that we talked about and understanding the world is about to change in ways that we did not think a year ago, what's exciting you? What's really exciting? What are we missing? What makes you really excited a year, 2 years, 5 years down the road?
Well, I think it's been a wonderful conversation. We've hit, I think, critical points and pragmatic points for institutional investors as they do their job right now. In creating value for their shareholders, for pension holders, for retail investors, and for many others that they have fiduciary responsibility for. There are two things that really excite me of the next few years. The first is the ability for this toolbox, AI, simulation, other tools to transform education. We all know about the failure of education. I don't mean just K through 12 education. I think we all agree on that. That we failed our students there. The idea of teaching to just the middle of the class doesn't work for anyone in the class, right? Everyone is turned off in the class, and we've all experienced that, and we've seen that across the board. We also have the massive divides in the world, the have and have nots. If we look at the scores in math and science and all these different areas, we can see that many countries, including the United States, needs a lot of help. United States is behind in many of these areas as well. So the ability for AI and other transformative tools to completely revolutionize how we think about education. We're still back in the Benjamin Franklin days of education, of 20, 30 seats in a class, a teacher in front. We still want that teacher, but the teacher now could become a coach, can become a mentor, can become a user of these technologies, and each student can have a personalized journey from the age of 4 or 5 to the age of 20, 30, 40, 50, and beyond. They can have that personalized AI that is going to stay with them, remember who they are. Today's GPTs, of course, we ask them questions. It doesn't know the next day that we're the same person who asked the question the previous day. But get ready very soon for personalized AIs that remember who Haim is, that remember the questions you asked yesterday, that remember that 10 years ago, when you were a youngster, you were very curious about how electronics worked or about, you know, how space works. And now 10 years later, you're asking another question about it and can tie it all together for you with multimedia, with video, with interactivity, with quizzes that are fun and exciting. This is the personal journey that our children can now start going through. And it's not just for children. The bigger part of the population is the adult population. And the idea that we just stop learning once we hit the workforce, that really is not a great idea at all. We want to keep learning. The best jobs in the world, we all know, the ones that keep people and highly retain people, are jobs that excite them to learn. And so companies that differentiate here, that offer continuous learning. At SandboxAQ, we're very proud of our culture, Haim. One of the tenets of our culture is lifelong learning. We not only give, course, budget for that, but we give time for that and dedication to that and encouragement and celebration of lifelong learning. And now with these tools, we can do that even more. So I think this is going to be not the golden, the platinum age of learning. It's not just, I could download some YouTube videos now. Now it's going to be a personal tutor that takes you through a journey of exploration and of excitement of discovery. So that's the first area, is the journey of learning. Let's go beyond just schools and education to personalized learning. We've all talked about it. Let's do it. The second area that has both great promise, but also danger, is robotics. So we've all talked about AI, we're all excited about AI, but how about embodied AI? You haven't seen AI until you've embodied AI. And by embodied AI, I mean AI in a humanoid format, in some kind of bodily form. Doesn't have to look like a human. In fact, it shouldn't look like a human. We know now from many previous studies, here's lesson one when it comes to robotics, Do not make them look human-like, skin and eyes and things like that. We call that the uncanny valley. Lots of studies around that. But when we look at the kinds of robots that will come out of Tesla, that will come out of Figure is a company that is in Silicon Valley now. People should look at this private company. Mentee Robotics is a third one that I encourage people to look at out of Israel, co-founded by Amnon Shashua, who became well-known, of course, before Mobileye and for selling that to Intel and running it again now as a spin-out from Intel. Amnon and others have founded Mentee Robotics, M-E-N-T-E. I have no relationship with any of these companies, but just mentioning these companies because they're leaders in the next generation of robotics. We're all familiar with industrial robots, big arms that help Toyota make cars very efficiently. Tesla has innovated in automotive construction robotics as well, and that's great, assembly robotics. This is a different kind of robot. This is a robot that's now being tested, for example, by Amazon's own internal robotics division and other companies they're working with. There was a video just came out about light assembly and also logistics, pick, pack, and ship in terms of warehousing and distribution centers. My prediction to you, Haim, you're in the business of predictions, so I'll leave all the predictions to you. But one prediction I would offer you, if you want to take it up in your reports, is that in the next 5 to 10 years, we are going to have millions, not thousands, but millions of humanoid robots walking on this earth, doing tasks that are helpful to us as humans. They're going to be in distribution centers, taking care of a lot of the menial work that otherwise give a lot of injuries to people. They're going to be in light assembly, putting together iPhones and other kinds of electronics. They're going to be in hospitals. Already, if you go to a hospital, for example, in Mountain View, there's a wonderful hospital there that is a small hospital, but an early adopter of technology because they're in Silicon Valley. You can see tugbots. A tugbot is a non-humanoid robot. It's just a big tuggish robot that tugs around a big basket of linens and towels and things like that on a fixed path across the hospital. But now you're going to see the next generation. You're going to see robots that are not doctors, they're not nurses, but they can go down to the pharmacy. They can bring up the medicine. They can sterilize rooms. Sterilizing a room is a very important aspect of going from patient to patient in a room. The best way to do that is with UV light. UV light is harmful to humans, so you don't want a human in there when you're doing it. And UV light would take care of a lot of the hospital-based bacteria that, as you know, are antibiotic resistant, such as MRSA. MRSA is very, very hard to get out of hospitals, but UV light can attack it. And robots are the best way to send into a room after one patient and before the next patient. So there's going to be several applications of these light humanoid robots. Of course, you combine it with LLMs. Now you get a nice interface with that robot. You combine it with computer vision. We didn't have time on this call, Haim, to talk about computer vision, but in the next call, we should talk more about the explosion that we're going to see in computer vision, driven by some of the breakthroughs in self-driving cars and other areas. But we're about to see computer vision take the next step. Just like LLMs have, we're about to see a similar revolution in computer vision. Anyway, putting all that together, in light robotics, the batteries have gotten a little better, a little more lightweight. So you can get about 5 hours now of useful time out of a humanoid robot before it goes down to its charging station, taking a break, charging up for about 25, 30 minutes, typically would be a charge time there. So we're already seeing practical applications. And Amazon, I predict, will be one of the early adopters of this technology. They'll work side by side with humans to take on some of the most dangerous type of tasks that are prone to various ergonomic issues that injure people. And so hospitals, distribution centers, light assembly, my prediction is we're going to see a lot of this. There are, of course, some risks that we have to look at, making sure that humans are safe around these robots, making sure there's no sudden movements and inadvertent accidents. So there's risks there to be looked at. But net-net, look for a lot of positive value of robotics. It's been talked about for 30 years, but this is one of those things that will be a 30-year overnight success in the next few years.
Wow, what an ending to a conversation that I could continue forever and ever. And I have so many questions. So first of all, Jack, I would really would love to have another one. Thank you so much for your time. And I can't wait for the next chapter.
Thanks, Haim.